Hello, welcome to the 16th program of Hammurabi INN Student. INN Student is a platform wherein law students get an opportunity to speak on the topic, whichever topic they wish to, on a topic they wish to research and they would present here. The main intention of this program is that students get a platform to speak and get confidence on it. Today on the 16th program, we are welcoming Ishita Kurani from MKS College of Law on the topic of Medico Legal. Well, thinking about this topic, Medico Legal is combination of all the laws of medical laws related to medicines, as well as how law of medicine is being implemented in the everyday's day-to-day life. So not wasting more time, I would like to call Ishita to speak on our topic.
Good afternoon, one and all present here. It gives me immense pleasure to give my insight on the topic medico-legal. Medico-legal, the word in our minds is how is medicine related to law, or how is medical profession related to legal profession? So here, my first topic is interrelationship between law and medicine. Professionals from medical, technical, scientific and legal fields rendering their valuable services to the society. They have their rights and obligations as well. For example, if an engineer is given the right to build up a bridge and if he is negligent about his services, this may lead to the death of a person and also national laws. Similarly, a doctor must be very careful by performing his duties. A single negligence is not only harm to others but also disgrace to the entire medical profession and including and leading to punishment. Medical profession is a noble profession, but sometimes its brightness is shadowed. This is due to the medicos who want to earn quick money by malpractices. This is very common in our country because the ratio of doctor patients is partly in our country. People opt for public hospitals rather than private hospital due to the economic instability because they get cheaper treatment in the public hospitals rather than private hospitals. Moving ahead in the topic, this may result to unnecessary deaths, operations and unnecessary clinical treatments leading to loss of human life. So, a medical case can be considered and defined as a case of injury, ailment, etc., in which investigation of a law enforcing agencies are essential to fix the responsibility regarding and causation of an injury of ailment. In simple language, I would like to explain that a medico-legal case can be defined as a case with legal implications when an attending doctor or a doctor treating the patient after examining his history feels that there is a need of legal implications for the same. It can also be the case where in a police station, if a case has arisen and it requires medical treatment or medical examination. So all the medical legal cases, it is the duty of the treating doctor to inform the nearest police station as soon as possible after the completing the primary safeguarding treatments. According to Section 39 of Criminal Procedure Code of India, it states that the idea is to initiate legal proceeding at the earliest so that maximum evidence can be collected by the police officers and there is the prevention of destruction of any evidence. Hence, we can say that medico-legal, it is the duty of the medical person or he is duty bound to intimidate such cases to the police. Moving ahead with the topic, I would like to throw a light in today's modernization. Due to today's modernization and willingness of the person amongst the patient, the patient always questions the doctor about the treatment, mode of treatment. This may lead to conflicting situations sometimes between the patient and doctor. Here, the Indian Medical Association and Medical Council Act of India initiate appropriate actions under regulations for infamous conduct of the medical men. Provisions regarding the same are provided and penal actions can also be taken. For this, the patient can gain compensation if there is any medical misconduct or any malpractices on the behalf of the doctor. Medical jurisprudence is the knowledge of law relation to the practice of medicine. It deals with those relationships that are generally recognized with legal consequences. The basic common three relationship: doctor-doctor relationship, doctor-patient relationship and doctor and state relationship. The very first is doctor and doctor relationship. A doctor criticizing his colleague in doing anything and making unfair practices may lead to consequences. The second relationship is a doctor and patient relationship, which is very common to all of us. Here, the doctor agrees to treat a patient and hence it has certain obligation and duties to be performed on his behalf for the patient. Now, over here, if there is any malpractices or negligence on behalf of the doctor in his duties, this may lead to facing him legal consequences. And the third relationship is doctor and state relationship. Here, the doctor and state relationship, a doctor is liable to face consequences if he does not attend the court in response of the summon. He is also liable if he does not inform the police or the court of any homicidal poisoning suspected or stabs, gunshots, wounds in his practices. He is also liable if he does not inform the police about any poisonous food being served in the hotel, restaurants or any stale food. And hence, it is the responsibility of the medical practitioners as well as the state to maintain standard health of the public of the state at large. Now, there are certain rules and regulations regarding the supply of medicines, that is known as drugs in the medical language. The scale shall be fair and reasonable, and the supply should be of standard quality and maximum purity. Then, the dangers of drugs are like to be abused. The use of narcotics is very dangerous, and hence it is likely to be used and restrained. So accordingly, the series of acts and rules regulations exist for the same. They are the Drugs and Cosmetics Act of 1940, the Drugs and Magic Remedies Act of 1954, the Drugs Control Act of 1950, and the Dangerous Drugs Act of 1930. The World Health Organization, the very prominent World Health Organization of 1948, has defined health as the state of complete physical, mental and social well-being and not merely the disease and infirmity. Hence, from the above definition, in simple language, we can conclude that there is no evidence of disease in a person and he is functioning normally and several organs of the body are functioning adequately. If the both of the reasons are satisfied, then a person is said to attain highest proportion of health. Before we saw the relationship of doctor and patient. Now, the doctor and patient is an implied contract. We can state it as an implied contract. And hence, between them, the doctor holds certain obligations. To complete those obligations, he needs to perform certain duties. These duties are self-regulatory duties. Now, self-regulatory duties in medical profession consist of two types: medical ethics and medical etiquettes. Now, moving forward to this topic, conventional laws and customary courtesies are generally followed by members of all professions, but the medical practitioners have to follow certain etiquettes. Example of this, if a doctor is treating his brotherly colleague, he should not charge any of his fees, and similarly also the family, also his family members and the family members of his colleagues. Moving ahead of medical ethics. Ethics are common norms and moral principles that should be performed by everyone in the society. Dealing with this, the patients also of the state. The motto is to honor and maintain notable traditions in medical profession and to uphold its dignity. Declaration of Geneva. The oldest code of medical ethics is a Hippocratic Oath. The World Health Association has renamed and now it is known as Declaration of Geneva. It is followed that Medical Council of India and Code of Ethics. Accordingly, every applicant doctor on the time of registration to become a medical practitioner should declare under this oath, and declaration should be signed below the concerned register. Regulations and Medical Degrees Act of 1916. This states that when a medical professional is opting for his degrees, there how and when accordingly the degree should be given. There are in total four sections. Sections 1 and 2 states that degrees in allopathy, surgery and obstetrics. Section 3 states that right of conferring, granting and issuing degrees, diplomas, licenses, certificates or other documents implying holder guarantee receipt and therefore qualified to practice Western medical services. Section 4 states that no other person was allowed to confer, grant or issue any degree, diploma, license or certificates or other documents implying the doctor guarantee receipt qualified to practice Western medical science. So Section 4 simply states that apart from the medical practitioner, no other person should be given the related degree. Medical misconduct, or we can say professional misconduct. This is the very common misconduct due to which a simple dent due to which the entire medical fraternity suffers for a long time. What is professional misconduct? when there is certain types of misconduct on the grounds of doctors, if not practicing properly to their patients or being negligent, it gives rise to professional misconduct. The remedies for the same are: the state council take cognizance of any offence, misconduct registered by the medical practitioner only when a written complaint in respect is received by the council of medical practitioner or convicted by law. The council hears the complaint and also the practitioner either through him or through his lawyer, and then advise any punitive action should be taken. Now, very common first professional misconduct is association with unqualified person. By unqualified person, we mean that person who does not have the knowledge of medical law. For example, if during when an anesthesia is given to the patient, the doctor assigns XYZ person. If the person does not have the knowledge and is giving anesthesia, means he has conducted professional misconduct of giving anesthesia because he does not have dignity of that much knowledge. Moving ahead, the second is advertising. Advertising medico laws in directly or indirectly are completely illegal. The third is adultery, which is known by all of us, that a doctor cannot abuse his position to seduce a female patient or any other member of the family. Abortion. Illegal abortion is also a misconduct in medico laws. A doctor cannot discriminate his patient on the basis of caste, race, sex, gender, and a doctor cannot issue any false birth certificate, death certificates, injuries, mental illness certificates, etc. Conviction by the court of law for offense involving moral turpitude and so on are included in professional misconduct. Coming to the most important part of the medico-legal laws, that is liability of professional negligence. By professional negligence, the word negligence does not only restricts itself to omission, but it has special meaning here. It covers omission as well as commission. By omission, we mean not doing a thing which is required to be done, and by commission, we think doing a thing which a reasonable person during that circumstances could not do. Negligence under medico-legal laws are actionable in both civil as well as in criminal courts. But here, it is necessary that to be proved by prosecution as culpable or gross and not negligence merely based on error of judgment. The consequences of negligence, product and liability are covered under Consumer Protection Act of 1986. In order to succeed the claim for negligence, a petitioner has to fulfill four conditions. The four conditions are: the defendant had owed certain duty towards the petitioner, and second, the defendant was not able to fulfill the duty, and it was a failure on his part. Third, the plaintiff suffered actual damages, and lastly, the defendant conduct was direct or proximate cause of the inflicted damages. If the plaintiff is satisfied in fulfilling all the conditions, then it can be leading to providing him compensation. For the same, the doctors need to safeguard their interest under doctor's indemnity insurance policy. Negligence are basically of three types: civil negligence, criminal negligence, and contributory negligence. Civil negligence: when a patient files a suit against a doctor in the civil court relating to deaths or any damages caused to the patient or relative friends, then it is known as civil negligence. It can also be vice versa. Example, a doctor filing a suit against the patient for recovering of professional fees on the grounds of malpractices. The liability of the doctor cannot be lessened. Such negligence took place on charitable institute. Means if it is a charitable institute, still the doctor is liable the same way, because the patient is to prove negligence on the damages measure on the amount of extent of liabilities. Also, it should be noted that the complaint of such negligence should be filed within 2 years of the date. And also, once the complaint filed in a court and the judgment is passed, the case cannot be reopened. The doctrine of res jurisdicta applies here. Very second negligence is criminal negligence. Criminal negligence arises due to death or serious injury caused by criminal undue interference of a doctor. In death, a doctor may be prosecuted and charged in criminal court along with criminal court having caused death of his patient due to rash negligent act not amounting to culpable homicide and is charged under 304 of A of Indian Penal Code. If the death was in gross negligence or gross ignorance due to the drunkenness and imperious efficiency of the duties, such cases are generally due to serious injury, the doctor may be charged under section 336, 337 and 338 of IPC. When a doctor violates penal provisions of law or complaint, cases filed, he is subjected to prosecution by the state. Similarly, a doctor is to report all the cases violating, like all the medico legal cases, to the nearest police station and commission so that a criminal act is suspected. But if he fails to abide these provisions, he can be charged and sued under section 202 of IPC. The last negligence is contributory negligence. When generally we go to the hospital, the doctor gives us the guidelines about what should be done, what should be not be done, the rules and regulations followed from our part apart from the treatment. But if we do not follow the particular rules and new rules and regulations and do not perform our duties, it is negligence on our side. That is amounting to contributory negligence. But while suing a doctor for contributory negligence, it is very important to be noted that the doctor told all the foreseen harm that could be caused. Now, contributory negligence can be a plea in civil courts and not in criminal courts. The reason for not in criminal courts is absolved of the charges of causing death, although the proof of contributory negligence may be reduced the gravity of offense. Means a criminal court, when there is a death of a person, the patient or doctor is liable, and hence it cannot be questioned on contributory negligence. Now, there are certain liabilities in medico legals. They are divided into two parts, the vicarious liabilities and the product liabilities. Vicarious liabilities means a damage is done by one person, but the liability falls on another person. This is a very common term in our law of torts. But in medico legal term, the doctors being registered as medical practitioners have liability on their own base and own code of conduct. But over the years, there has been a lot of advancement, and five types of liabilities are being prescribed. Very first thing, the hospital management is responsible for negligent act of the resident physicians, interns and trainees who are considered as employees when performing normal duties. Second, the hospital management is not responsible for negligent act of senior doctor, specialist and consultant. Third, a physician is responsible for all the acts of resident doctors, interns work under immediate and direct control. Fourth, a physician is responsible under doctrine of negligent choice. I repeat, she is responsible or he is responsible under doctrine of negligent choice. He refers his patient to incompetent and inappropriate doctor. He is also responsible if otherwise. Physicians and surgeons are not responsible for the act of qualified nurses. Such acts are carried out under their immediate supervision and control. To the main. Now, the second thing is product liability. Generally, when there is a damage to the patient due to lack of instrument or due to the incapacity of instrument, the patient, as a layman, feels that the doctor is liable. So, he may sue the doctor. But here, when it is a product liability, the doctor should not be sued, but the manufacturer of the instrument should be sued due to which there was an inconsistency in the treatment. So the manufacturer will be held liable for using substandard products and improper assembly and defective design. Hence, in certain cases, there is always, when the treatment lacks due to not proper product or there is a damage defect with the product and not due to the negligence of the doctor, this should be taken care of while the treatment. That is, there a negligence of the doctor really, or it is the negligence of the treatment? Liabilities and doctors on the Consumer Protection Act 1986. 1986 Consumer Protection Act is a basic act giving all the rules and regulations about the medico-legal. So, it has the enactment of this act itself provided a remedy, a quasi-judicial relief, and also cheap and quickest services. The courts divided hospital into three parts. First part is the hospitals rendering free services and to all people who are availing them. Second, the hospitals rendering paid services to people of availing it. And third, hospitals rendering paid services to certain people and also free services to the people who are below the economic stability or below poverty line. Accordingly, in medical negligence complaint, the complaint can be filed in district forum if the value of the goods is below 20 lakhs, in state commission if it is between 20 lakhs and 1 crore but not exceeding 1 crore rupees, and in national commission if it exceeds 1 crore rupees, which is situated in Delhi. Penal provisions. Section 268 to 278 and sections 284 to 286 are related to public health and negligent misconduct. Sections 268 to 278 and section 284 to 286, which are related to public health and negligent conduct, are mentioned. Here, section 268 refers to public nuisance. A person is guilty of public nuisance who does not act or is guilty of an illegal omission, which is caused by common injury, danger, and annoyance to the public, to the people general, who dwell, occupy the property in a vicinity, or which is necessary caused by injury, obstruction, danger, or annoyance of the person who has the right to public right. Working of a motorcycle engine for a short period does not amount to public nuisance. It should be noted that working of a motorcycle engine for a short period should not amount to public nuisance. Section 272, adulteration of food or drinking intended for sale. Whoever adulterates any article of food or drink so to make such article nauseous as food or drink, attending to sell such article of food or drink, or knowing it likely to be the same will be sold as food or drink, shall be punishable with imprisonment or either prescriptions for the term which may extend to 6 months, or with a fine which may extend to rupees 1000, or with both. Adulteration of drugs, section 274. Whoever adulterates any drugs or medical preparation in such a manner is to lessen the efficiency or change the operation of a drug or medical preparation, or to make nauseous, intending that it to be sold, used any medical purpose, as it had to be undergone such adulteration, shall be punished with imprisonment of either description for a term which may extend to 6 months, or with a fine of extend to 1000 rupees, or both. Lastly, section 286, negligent in conduct with respect to explosive substance. Whoever does with explosive substance act like to rashly or negligently as endanger human life, or to be likely to cause hurt or injury or any other person, or knowingly or negligently omits to take such order with explosive substance which is possession as insufficient to guard against the probable danger of human life for the substance, shall be punished with the imprisonment of either description of the term which may extend to 6 months, or with fine which may extend to 1000 rupees, or both. Further sections are attached in the link below. Please do go and check. Now, there are certain cases which are known as medico legal cases. All the these cases include injuries, burns, and circumstances which suggest of commission of an offense, cases with grievous hurt, evident of sexual assault, evident of criminal abortion, cases of unconsciousness where the cause of natural is not clear, causes of self-suspect and injuries to commit suicide, and all cases suspected or evident poisoning or intoxication. Apart from above mentioned cases, there are many other cases that are included in the same. There is a certain procedure to be followed while you file a medico-legal case. The very first thing is the treatment. All legal formalities should be suspended till the patient is restituted. Identification. It is very important to identify whether the case is medico-legal case or it is not medico-legal case. Third is intimation to the police. As soon as we identify that the case is a medico-legal case, our first step should be that we should inform the police for the same for further actions. Acknowledgement received. From the police, you should always receive an acknowledgement received for future for references. What is a medico-legal report? Medico-legal report is prepared and it is a written report for the doctor in the role of a medical expert, witnesses in a legal case. Medical reporting provide medical legal reports in civil claims for damages for victims of personal injury, diseases, and medical negligence. When and instructed by the client, we select the most appropriate medical expert witnesses from our extensive network to prepare the report, considering specialization, location, experience. All of the medical reports meet requirements of civil procedure codes, and then only they are applicable. Any medical report should always meet the requirement of the civil procedure code for their applicability. Lastly, the format of a medical legal report. The medical legal report which we prepare should have a certain format. The very first thing is the patient's name and the date of birth. Second is requesting party's name, date of request and purpose of the report. Third is the credentials, including professional address, qualification, experience and the position at the time involved. Fourth is medical facts in chronological order. They are presentation, examination, investigation, provision, treatment and current conditions. And lastly, there is a box for responses and your opinions. Hence, I would like to conclude that a medico-legal cases, according to section 39, it is important for a doctor to inform the police as soon as he comes to know that it is a medico-legal cases, and a doctor's responsibility always to safeguard the life of the people. And also, quick action of the police helps to avoid the destruction of evidence by treating physician. By this, I mean that quick action of the police, if the police investigates, if there is a lot of time in informing, and then the police will take the action. Between that time, there can be the evidence can be lost. There can be any destruction of evidence. Hence, it is really very important to inform the police as soon as possible. Lastly, I would like to thank Advocate Rahul sir, Mr. Chirag, the student coordinator, and the entire team of Hammurabi tablet to giving me such a wonderful opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Ishita. It was a nice lecture where we heard lot of aspects as regards medico-legal connection, medical laws, their interpretations and several things. So thank you very much, and this is a short thing from Hammurabi to you.
Thank you, sir.
As a memory.
Yeah.
And welcome to Team Hammurabi.
Thank you, sir.